You might have heard the words cutoff, saturation, or forward active before. These are typical modes of operation for bipolar transistors. In this video, we're going to look at each of these modes in more detail, and I'll show you how you can arrange the circuitry around a transistor in order to achieve the desired mode of operation. Some of the modes are desirable, and some of them are undesirable. Let's get started with the first mode, cutoff. As you might recall, a bipolar junction transistor can be used as a switch. A signal, or a signal voltage, that's applied to the base of the bipolar junction transistor can be used to switch on and off much larger amounts of current, which flow down through the collector and out through the emitter of the bipolar transistor. If you have a large amount of current that's flowing, then the transistor is said to be on. But if there's no current flowing at all, then the transistor is said to be off. That's the cutoff mode that we're talking about here. What kind of signal would I need to apply to the base of a bipolar transistor in order to make sure that there's no current flowing? Well, first of all, let's consider what would happen if we had zero voltage or a floating pin attached to the collector of the transistor. In this kind of situation, it doesn't matter what signal I would apply to the base. You're never going to get any current flowing down through the transistor because there's no source for that current. Let's then be clear here that I'm referring to situations where we have a DC power supply connected to the collector. For example, we might have 5 volts or 10 volts connected up here to the collector. Likewise, you're never going to get any current flowing through the transistor if the emitter is floating. The emitter has to be connected to a lower voltage. We might have a resistor here, or it might just be grounded, but I'm going to show the situation where it's simply grounded. And since we're talking about using the transistor as a switch, I'm going to attach a resistor in between the DC power supply and the collector. This is our load. What we want to do with the transistor is control whether or not current is flowing through the load or not flowing through the load. In the configuration that I've just drawn, it's at least possible for current to flow down from the DC power supply through the load, through the transistor, and down to ground. If that chain is broken, then it doesn't really make sense to talk about whether the transistor is in cutoff or not, because current's not even possible to flow. So we have to first start with the assumption that current flow is possible, and it's the transistor itself that has to switch that current flow on or off. Therefore, the configuration as shown with the transistor is really similar to the situation as if I just had a switch. The transistor itself acts as the switch. It's either on or it's off. If current is at least possible to flow and the transistor is switched off, then it's operating in the cutoff mode. And that's what we're talking about here. How do we get the transistor to switch on or switch off? What really matters is the base emitter junction voltage. Let's go ahead and label it here. I'll call it VBE. The transistor shown is an NPN transistor. It means that the base is attached to P-type doped material and the emitter is attached to N-type doped material. It's a forward bias PN junction if the voltage here is positive. If the transistor is made from silicon, then you need at least 0.6, 0.7 volts in order to turn on the diode, so to speak. Therefore, in order to turn on the transistor, we need a VBE of greater than 0.7 volts or so. Cutoff then refers to the situation where this is not achieved. If the signal applied, say, is a DC voltage, 0.5 volts, for example, then the diode's not going to turn on. No current can flow through the base, and consequently, no current will be able to flow down into the collector. What I've just drawn is an example of a transistor that's in the cutoff mode. What if it were 0.1 volts? Well, it would still be cut off because the voltage drop from base to emitter is too low. What if it were negative 0.1? No, that doesn't work either because this is now a reverse bias diode. Current can't normally flow through a reverse bias diode, can it? What if it were 0.8 volts? Well, that's higher than 0.7, so we're definitely going to switch it on. One has to be very careful though, because if the base emitter voltage drop is too high, then you can switch the transistor on so much that it could burn it out. We'll get to that when we talk about some of the other modes of operation. But I think you can see that cutoff is very easy to define. You just think of the transistor as a switch. It's either on or it's off, and it's that base emitter junction voltage that determines it. Let's move on to the forward active mode. And to discuss it, I want to label all three of the terminals of the transistor. We're going to have a collector with a particular voltage, a base with a particular voltage, and also an emitter with a particular voltage. Notice how the arrow kind of points downwards here. That's what you normally want. You want the high voltages labeled at the top of your drawing, and then the voltages should get lower and lower as you reach the bottom of your schematic. If the voltages properly descend from top to bottom, the transistor is normally in the forward active mode, provided that it's not cut off. So if you've arranged a circuit and you've verified that the base emitter voltage drop is 0.7 volts or higher, then we know that the transistor is not in the cutoff mode. Then, if the voltages are properly arranged from the top down, from high to low, then it's going to be in the forward active mode. Let's put some voltages on it and see an example. Let's say that I have a 1 kiloohm resistor attached to the collector and a 1 kiloohm resistor attached to the emitter. The resistor will be attached to a 10 volt DC power supply. Let's say that I've attached a 1 volt DC power supply to the base. Is this transistor in the forward active mode or not? Well, the first thing we need to do is find the base emitter voltage drop. Is it possible that this transistor is forward biased? We can start off by assuming that we have a 0.7 volt drop and see if we later reach a contradiction. A contradiction could be reached, for example, if we later find that current is flowing the wrong way from emitter to the base. By inspection, our base voltage equals 1 volt. It's just attached to the power supply. Our emitter voltage is 0.7 volts down from that, so that would make 0.3 volts. If the emitter is at 0.3 volts, then we can confirm that the current through the emitter is going to be flowing in the correct direction. What's that current going to be? Let's label it IE. And we can just use Ohm's law to calculate it. VE is just IE times the emitter resistance, which is 1 kiloohm. The emitter current's 300 microamps. That's not very much current, but it's still flowing. That current is largely going to be coming from the collector. The collector current thus almost equals 300 microamps as well. Now, the reason I'm saying here almost is because if we look at the drawing, we see that we have another terminal. The base current's going to flow in there as well. So strictly speaking, the emitter current is the sum of the collector current and the base current. But the base current tends to be very small, and you want it to be small. If it's not small, then something's wrong. In this case, it's small enough that we're just going to neglect it. You might recall that the base current is typically a factor of beta, which is typically around 100 or so, different from the collector current. Let's then find the collector voltage. We can use Ohm's law across this resistor in order to find it. It's going to be slightly lower than 10 volts. It's going to be 9.7 volts. Now let's see if the transistor is in the forward active mode or not. If it's in the forward active mode, VC should be higher than VB. VB should be higher than VE. All right, so the collector is at 9.7, the base is at 1, and the emitter is at 0.3. That's the correct order. This transistor is on. On here, meaning forward active mode. Before I move on to the saturation mode, I want to spend just a moment here discussing the reverse active mode. This is never used, but it's a theoretically possible mode for a transistor to operate in. The reason is because a transistor is an NPN junction. If the doping of the emitter and collector were hypothetically the same, then they would be identical. You could just turn the transistor upside down and ought to work the same way. However, in most bipolar transistors, the emitter is much more heavily doped than the collector, meaning it's an asymmetric device. It won't work as well if you turn it upside down. You could still, though, hypothetically get it to work. It wouldn't work very well, but you could still hypothetically get it to work if you turn the transistor upside down and then arrange the voltages from high to low. Effectively, though, my labels are not entirely accurate anymore. I'm calling this the voltage at the emitter because I know it's the emitter due to the presence of the arrow here on the drawing, but really it's not the emitter. I'm using it as a collector. It's just an incorrectly doped collector. Likewise, I'm using the collector as the emitter. It's just a very poorly designed emitter. It's a much lighter doped emitter than what a transistor would ordinarily have. Current might flow in the correct direction through such a transistor. In order to tell whether or not it's in the reverse active mode, it's this base emitter junction that I need to compare to 0.7 volts. It's just that I now need to imagine that the collector is the emitter and that the emitter is the collector. With that imagination in mind, you could probably get the transistor to work, but nobody ever uses it like that. It's a mistake. Let's now move on to saturation, the fourth mode of operation, or the third one that anybody ordinarily uses. I mentioned that for a transistor to be in the forward active mode, you would want to have the voltages neatly arranged from the top down. That is, the collector would need to be at a higher voltage, the base would be at a medium voltage, and the emitter would be at a lower voltage, roughly 0.7 volts down from the base. What if you don't have the collector at a high enough voltage though? What if it's not in cutoff? In other words, you have a high enough voltage from base to emitter, but the collector voltage is too low. That's called saturation. This transistor, for example, is biased in the saturation region. The base voltage is higher than the collector voltage. Current is not going to be able to flow correctly down through the transistor. Now, it's still going to flow. It's just no longer going to increase as the base voltage increases. Let's now take a moment to talk about the way current ordinarily flows in a transistor. If the transistor is not in cutoff, that is, if the base emitter junction is higher than about 0.7 volts, then current will properly flow from the base down into the emitter. That will initiate and control a much larger current flow from the collector down through the emitter. Now, when you look at this, you can say, well, this is a forward-biased PN junction right here. But when you look up here at the collector base junction, though, you might say, oh my goodness, that's reverse biased. Why should there be a lot of current flowing down through a reverse biased junction? Well, I'm not going to go into it in this video, but suffice it to say that that's the ordinary operation of a bipolar transistor. The current flows through the reverse biased junction because of what's happening at the base emitter junction. What I'm saying is that it's normal for that junction to be reverse biased, and ordinarily you can get a lot of current going down through it. But what we're talking about here in saturation is when you don't have it reverse biased. What I've just drawn is the forward active mode. What would saturation be like? Well, in saturation, the current flow is going to be limited. Normally, when you change the base current in a transistor, you would expect a proportional change in the collector current. But in a transistor that's saturated, you're no longer going to get this proportional change. The collector current is clamped, it's saturated. If the base voltage is large enough relative to the collector, for example, if the collector were just grounded, you could even get current flow in the wrong direction through the transistor. It's just like two forward bias diodes. When you're setting up a transistor to use as either a switch or an amplifier, there's three things that I recommend you consider. First of all, is the base emitter junction voltage greater than 0.7 volts? If it is, then the transistor is not in the cutoff mode. Secondly, I recommend that you keep your base current negligible. And the reason for that is it makes the voltages much easier to predict around the transistor. Thirdly, if the transistor is going to work properly as an amplifier, then the collector voltage should be higher than the base voltage, which should be higher than the emitter voltage. In other words, you want to target the forward active mode. You don't want the transistor to be in saturation. In the next video, we'll look at a few examples so you can get some practice in identifying the mode of operation.